Brothers and sisters, may I present before you Dr. Jamal Badawi to speak on unity of Muslims.
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa liyus salihin, wa ashhadu anna sayyidana wa nabiyyana wa habibana Muhammadan Rasulullah, qatamul anbiya'i wa sayyidul mursaleen, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I stand before you tonight, not as a scholar of Islam, as Dr. Muhammad said, but as a minor student of Islam, but who is eager, however, to share whatever little he learns with his brothers and sisters. The topic assigned to me is a paramount and important one, and I'm not sure whether I can really do justice to it in this time, but inshallah, we will try. And as we try, we are trying to approach the topic from three basic areas. One is, what is the meaning and concept of unity in Islam? Secondly, the basis of that unity. Thirdly, a more concrete question about managing our differences as Muslims. First of all, the meaning of unity. If there is any religion par excellence that is based on unity, where the concept of unity is so deeply entrenched in every aspect of its teaching, it is Islam. Of course, we begin with the unity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unity of uluhiyya, unity of rububiyya, unity of asma and sifat. There is unity in the universe also. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, inna kulla shay'in khalaqnahu biqadr. Everything have we created in due measure. So there is unity in the universe. Three, there is unity also between belief and action in Islam. And oftentimes when we read in the Quran, inna alladhina amanu wa amilu salihat, those who believe and did righteous deeds. Fourthly, there is unity between love, the love of Allah, and manifestation of that love in our action. As we read in the Quran, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Say, if indeed you love Allah, follow me, means Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah will love you more and forgive your sins. Fifthly, it is the religion of unity between this life and the hereafter, not sacrificing one for the other. We read also in the Quran, وَابْتَغِ فِي مَا أَتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةَ وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ وَلَا تَبْغِ الْفَسَادَ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. Seek in what Allah has given to you the hereafter, but forget not your share in this life. Be good as Allah has been good to you. Seek not corruption on earth, for Allah doesn't love those who commit corruption. Sixthly, it is the religion of unity between individual behavior and collective behavior. Individuals have to behave Islamically, but always the Quran addresses us also as a group, as a unity, as an ummah. Seventhly, it is the religion of unity also of all of mankind. On one level, even unity of all believing and non-believing. As we read in Surah Al-Hujurat, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ, it says, not all believers, not all Muslims, all mankind, all of you. We created you from a single pair of a male and female, or you can translate it from male and female. And we made of you nations and tribes that you may get to know one another. The most honored of you in the sight of Allah is one who is more righteous in need. So there is unity even on the entirety of mankind. However, within the broader unity of mankind, we find another important unity, the ukhuwa or brotherhood of Iman. Because without Muslims beginning with themselves, giving good example of brotherhood, at least brotherhood of faith, they will not be successful in bringing humanity together in this broader brotherhood under the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For that reason, we find the Quran ties between unity of Muslim and the most important aspect of Islam, the cornerstone, Tawheed. Look at this ayah. إِنَّ هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَاعْبُدُونَ. This is your ummah. One ummah means the Muslim ummah. One ummah, and I am your Lord, so worship me. Worship of Allah and unity of ummah goes hand in hand. You notice here again that the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the unity of the ummah is not limited to individuals, but we are again addressed as a collectivity. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't say your nation, your country, your race, but use the word ummah that often time has been translated as nation, which is an erroneous translation. A community of believers that transcends all barrier of race, color, gender, or whatnot. This unity appears also in the Quran not as a luxury, but as a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As you read here, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. Hold tight to the rope of Allah and be not divided. In fact, the Quran also warns us against disunity and division. وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا فَتَفْشَلُوا وَتَذْهَبَ رِيحُكُمْ وَاصْبِرُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Don't fall into disputation with one another, lest you may fail and your power will be gone. And be patient. Allah will be with those who persevere. It warns us, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ فَرَّقُوا دِينَهُمْ وَكَانُوا شِيَعًا لَسْتَ مِنْهُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ. Those who divided their religion, made divisions and disputations, and became sects, you, means Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, have nothing to do with them. Actually, it connects division with shirk. وَلَا تَكُونُوا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ مِنَ الَّذِينَ فَرَّقُوا دِينَهُمْ وَكَانُوا شِيَعًا كُلُّ حِزْبٍ بِمَا لَدَيْهِمْ فَرِحُونَ. It tells Muslims, don't be among those mushriks, like those mushriks who were divided in their religion and became sects. Every sect is so happy with what they got. I'd like to end that part with an observation that the Quran indicates to us that disunity and unnecessary disputations do not necessarily stem from lack of knowledge. In fact, it is in spite of the knowledge, in spite of the revelation. When the Quran speaks about what happened to the people of the book, in Surah Al-Bayyinah, وَمَا تَفَرَّقَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَتْهُمُ الْبَيِّنَةِ. The people of the book did not fall into divisions except after the evidence has been revealed to them. The scriptures, the teaching were there. وَمَا اخْتَلَفَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَهُمُ الْعِلْمُ بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ. This ayah gives the reason why people dispute in spite of knowledge. The free translation, those who have been given knowledge before did not fall into division and disputation except after knowledge has been given to them. Why? بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ. Because of oppression. What are the basis that makes Muslim unity, at least in theory, very important and very powerful? There are at least five important bases. They're very simple. We all know them, but we seldom really think much about them. The first, that all Muslims, the whole ummah, believe in the one and only creator, sustainer, and cherisher of the universe, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has protected this ummah from any major confusion about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about His asma, His attributes, His qualities. We have been protected in a way that is far ahead of what happened to the followers of previous prophets, who still until today, thousands of years after the Prophet came, argue about the nature of deity. Alhamdulillah. With the exception of few deviations historically that were minor. They might have some extension, but they're really minor on the fringes of Islam. The whole Muslim ummah, regardless of their schools of jurisprudence, interpretations, ways of thinking throughout time, has agreed on that basic core about the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similar to that is the belief in the other fundamental articles of faith. Believe in the angels of Allah, the prophets of Allah, the books of Allah, the life hereafter, qadr. No dispute about those essential concepts. There may be argument about details or interpretation, but there's no dispute about these core principles. And my question here is this, not necessarily to you, to the whole ummah, and to myself as one member of that ummah. If this is the case, why is it that we find divisions and splits among Muslims who believe and worship the one and same Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The second reason, or base, all Muslims, regardless of a school of jurisprudence, believe in the final and same messenger of Allah, the seal and leader and imam of all of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in whose mission the whole prophetic tradition has been perfected, completed, manifested. No dispute about that. Why is it then we find divisions and splits among Muslims who believe and follow the same leader, about whose life, through the Quran and through Hadith and other sources, we have a lot more than any nation in the past learned about their prophet? Thirdly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed this ummah, and this is a unique blessing. Compare it with any other community of faith. A unique blessing of this ummah, that Allah revealed to it a book, which is His direct revelation, direct words, not communicated through the minds of human beings and their own thinking. The Quran, which is described in the Quran itself in Surah 41, لا يأتيه الباطل من بين يديه ولا من خلفه. تنزيل من حكيم حميد. Falsehood does not approach it from before it or from behind it. A Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself took care of preserving it. You know, some of my Christian friends sometimes ask me that question. They say, you people say that the Bible also is revelation from Allah, or what the prophets received. Actually, there is no term such as Bible in the Quran. There is no term in the Quran that speaks about Old Testament or New Testament. The Quran speaks about the original revelation given to the prophets. You say you believe in those scriptures, and you believe that only the Quran was preserved. And if this were the word of God, why God did not preserve His word? And what they forget is that the Quran itself says that the duty for preservation of previous scriptures were given as a responsibility to the rabbis. إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَا التَّوْرَاةَ فِيهَا هُدًى وَنُورٌ يَحْكُمُ بِهَا النَّبِيُّونَ الَّذِينَ أَسْلَمُوا لِلرَّبَّيُّونَ وَالْأَحْبَارُ بِمَا اسْتُحْفِظُوا. You see, the word استحفظوا in the Quran means that these rabbis, these clergy, were given the responsibility to preserve the word of Allah. So if they failed to preserve it, it's not a failure on the part of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the Quran, however, because it is the last revelation of Allah, Allah Himself said, right, I'll take care of preserving it myself. I would not entrust it to anyone. I look after its preservation. Where do we find it? Surah Al-Hijr. إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. It is we, means Allah, we of course for glory, not plurality. We revealed the reminder or the message, means the Quran, and it is we who are going to preserve it. Burn all the copies of the Quran in the world, the Quran still will be preserved, because Allah took care Himself of preserving His book. My question here, why then the divisions and splits among Muslims when they believe in one final authority, no versions with different contents, same Quran, word for word, without any disputation, which has been elaborated also and explained in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Fourthly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed this ummah with a clear vision, with a clear understanding of its mission on earth, that is to seek the pleasure of Allah through the fulfillment of its duty of khilafah or trusteeship, struggling to support the truth, shunning falsehood, enjoining good and forbidding evil. An ummah that believes in the final accountability when we stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala someday to account for our lives, a day when no wealth or children would be of any help, except as Allah says in the Quran, إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ, except those who come to Allah with a clean heart. The question again,
If this is the case, why we as a Muslim ummah suffer from division and splits and unnecessary disputation? If all of us one day will be under piles of dirt in the earth waiting for our accountability, actually our accountability begins with our burial. Why can't we, in preparation for that day, do our best to resolve our differences in an Islamic manner, not to be insistent, arrogant, or proud? Because after all, we came from the dust, and to dust we are returning. Fifthly, the dangers facing this ummah are the same. Muslims might have different madhabs they follow. They might follow different jurisprudence in some details. But the adversaries of this ummah, in spite of their differences and splits, they're all united against the Muslim ummah. They're all united to attempt to extinguish the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He willed to be spread through the functionality of this ummah. And when those enemies of the truth, when those evil forces in the world, no matter what kind of cover, deceptive banners they come under, when they slaughter Muslims, they don't ask a Muslim or victim, are you Sunni or Shia? Are you Hanafi, Hanbali, or Maliki, or whatever? Do you have a beard or not? Is your beard according to the specific description, according to some interpretation or not? Do you wear cap or not? They don't even ask whether you keep regular prayer or not. They don't ask whether you're a strict, quote-unquote, according to their definition, Muslim or not. Suffice to have even the slightest connection with the Muslim ummah to deserve to be slaughtered. We have seen that. We have seen that many times. We have seen that in the destruction of Khilafah in Turkey at the hands of Masons working on behalf of the enemies of Islam. We have seen that in the period of colonialism, in the occupation of Palestine, in the casualties of Muslims in the so-called Gulf War, let's call it oil war, in Kashmir, Bosnia-Herzegovina, and lately in Kosovo and many other parts of the world. They don't ask what kind of a Muslim you are. Suffice to have even a Muslim name without practicing anything of Islam to deserve that. If this is the case, if these are the common dangers, the dangers on the part of those who were able to unite themselves economically, militarily, strategically, and politically in order to suppress Muslims, why is it that we find divisions and splits among Muslims instead of the logical requirement of solidarity, mutual love, and concern? But let me come beyond those generalities to the third and final part, and I consider it to be more important. How do we manage, or should manage, our differences? Is there any difference in understanding an inherent evil in the Muslim ummah? To begin with, we must say that there are acceptable differences that could arise between Muslims. And the difficulty with the Muslim ummah is not because there is difference of opinion about some details. The real difficulty and the real problem is the failure of the Muslim ummah to learn how to manage differences. Difference of views is a natural thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created people with varieties, abilities. They come from varieties of backgrounds, and that itself results in differing ways. Even if you accept all the principle, there would be some difference of opinion in some areas. But that difference actually could be positive in itself, for it allows the cross-fertilization of ideas, exchange, critique, rather than just having one opinion and everybody follows without thinking in details like this. In fact, there is one amazing ayah in the Quran that establishes the concept of plurality in society. Plurality. Even plurality of people living from various religious backgrounds living together. Look at this ayah in Surah Hud. وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَجَعَلَ النَّاسَ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا. If your Lord willed, He would have made all people one ummah. All people. In another ayah, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَآمَنَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كُلُّهُمْ جَمِيعًا. If your Lord will, all of the people of the earth would have believed. There are two implications. One of them directly related to our topic. But one implication here that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself willed that there will be people following different ways. Yes, you can call iman and kufr fine, but that's the will of Allah. Who are you to try to force people to believe against their will? The theological correctness is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge everybody in the day of judgment. But so long as you're living here on the earth, you have to deal with all people in justice and honor and fairness and mercy. You can do da'wah to them. If they don't accept it, live with them courteously, leave it to Allah to judge them. But the implication that is very much relevant to us here, if that applies even in the plurality among followers of religions, how about plurality in some detailed interpretations of certain issues within the basic boundaries of Sharia? Who is anyone to say that all details must have one uniform opinion? And by the way, it must be my opinion. But if we conclude then that some differences could be positive and functional, useful in fact, we must ask ourselves, what are the conditions, as the ulama have listed them, what are the conditions for positive differing opinions? Number one, it could not and should not be difference in usul, in basics. The fundamentals, as the ulama call it, al-ma'ruf min ad-din bil-darura, things that are known of religion, of necessity, things that could not be disputed, that they are all common core that all Muslims, regardless, are supposed to accept. But I must say, by way of an observation here, that some people magnify smaller differences so as to appear as difference in usul, in basics. You come to someone who is unlettered Muslim, who believe instinctively in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, understand tawheed in their simple way, and start giving them something like an inquisitive exam. And you have to answer these questions. Have you memorized Al-Aqidah Al-Tahawiyya? Have you memorized the fatwas of Ibn Taymiyyah? And they start asking you so high philosophical type of questions about Allah. And if that simple person gives the wrong answer innocently, oh, he's a kafir. His aqidah is doubtful. So a small difference of opinion, or difference of understanding, or even lack of knowledge is automatically connected with usul. So with this we have to be careful about, not to make a small issue, make it bigger, bigger and bigger until it becomes an issue of iman and kufr. If we conclude then that some differences could be positive and functional, useful in fact, we must ask ourselves, what are the conditions, as the ulama have listed them, what are the conditions for positive differing opinions? Number one, it could not and should not be difference in usul, in basics. The fundamentals, as the ulama call it, al-ma'ruf min ad-din bil-darura, things that are known of religion, of necessity, things that could not be disputed, that they are all common core that all Muslims, regardless, are supposed to accept. But I must say, by way of an observation here, that some people magnify smaller differences so as to appear as difference in usul, in basics. You come to someone who is unlettered Muslim, who believe instinctively in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, understand tawheed in their simple way, and start giving them something like an inquisitive exam. And you have to answer these questions. Have you memorized Al-Aqidah Al-Tahawiyya? Have you memorized the fatwas of Ibn Taymiyyah? And they start asking you so high philosophical type of questions about Allah. And if that simple person gives the wrong answer innocently, oh, he's a kafir. His aqidah is doubtful. So a small difference of opinion, or difference of understanding, or even lack of knowledge is automatically connected with usul. So with this we have to be careful about, not to make a small issue, make it bigger, bigger and bigger until it becomes an issue of iman and kufr. Whenever somebody came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to embrace Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not engage him in a 2 hours exam, oral exam, about عقيدة طحوية and fatwa of this and fatwa of that and philosophy of this and معتزلة and جهمية and this and that. It never happened. Do you bear witness that there is no God but Allah and that I am the messenger of Allah? He said yes, alhamdulillah, he became a Muslim. Then he grows and learned about Islam. But people sometimes complicate things unnecessarily. Yes, scholars can argue about that, but we should not magnify those issues. It just reminds me of a story, I don't know where I heard it or from whom, might be brothers, I don't know. One sister who was engaged by a brother, and to make sure that his aqeedah, his belief is correct, I think she had an interview with him for a whole day, and after all that day she said, I'm not quite sure. After all the quizzing for the whole day whether his tawheed is correct or not. Are we complicating things unduly? Which means then that the first rule, that there could be no difference in usul, but there could be difference in furu', in branches, in minor issues. A second condition for positive difference, that even if there is difference in minor issues, it should be avoided or narrowed down as much as possible. If you can't avoid it totally, and it's impossible to avoid totally, you must narrow the scope of those smaller differences. The third condition is sincerity. And this is only known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to ask our hearts individually, ask ourselves, that our purpose behind discussion and debating certain issues, detailed issues, should be to search for truth and to accept that truth so long as it became clear and manifest, not to feel any pride, but even to thank the brother or sister who helped us discover that truth. It is possible that a person did not know about one hadith, for example. Instead of continuing to argue and argue, once the hadith is proven to be authentic, a person should not hesitate to accept. The fourth and fifth conditions I'm going to elaborate a little bit on. One is that even if you have a debate or discussion with your brother or sister on a given issue, and you present it to him what you think is a conclusive and clear evidence, but he was not convinced, that you should not interpret that automatically as pride or rejection of truth. You have to give the benefit of doubt. And the jurist mentioned a number of things. It might sound a little dry, but I'll go through them very quickly to show that the issue is not that simplistic or trivialized. Example. You said, I said to my brother there is a hadith, and I quoted the hadith, but he didn't still accept my opinion. The answer, yes. The person could be a scholar who is aware of some deficiency in that hadith. The scholar of hadith call it illah. There is some weakness in that hadith that makes it weak. Secondly, two scholars could have heard about the same hadith, but they heard about it with differing words. And on the basis of differing words, or variant words, they came up with differing interpretations, even though it's basically one hadith on the same topic. Thirdly, maybe that scholar knows something about the occasion of that hadith. There are also some information, even though it's not as much about, just like we have occasions of revelation in the case of the Quran, there are also some information about some hadith. So maybe the scholar is aware of the occasion when that hadith was said, which may shape how it should be properly interpreted. Fourthly, the rawi, or the narrator of the hadith, one narrator could have heard part of the hadith, another narrator could have heard the entire hadith. So we take one hadith against the other, the more complete hadith will give a better meaning and better base for interpretation. Fifthly, a person could have heard the hadith, but he could be a scholar and he knows of another hadith which is of higher authenticity, on the basis of which he came up with his verdict or opinion. Sixthly, yes, the hadith could be there, but the scholar may be aware of reason to believe that there was naskh or takhsis, meaning there's supersession, that something came after that hadith, like when the Prophet ﷺ say, I forbade you before from visiting the graves, but now visit it. So a person may not be aware of that other hadith, or takhsis, which means some statement on the part of the Prophet ﷺ, or some reason to believe that the meaning of that hadith or implication is not as general as it may appear, but there is some reason to believe there is specificity in its application. A seventh point, maybe the most difficult of all, in the question of why should you give benefit of doubt. that even the science known as usul al-fiqh, the roots of Islamic law, is a science also which is based, yes, on the Quran and Sunnah, but in some specifics, the scholars of usul themselves differ. There are certain things, of course, they don't disagree. All of them accept the Quran and Sunnah as the primary sources. But issues like qiyas, analogy, istihsan, masalih, the interest of the ummah, there have been differing positions even by the scholars of usul as to which one take precedent over the other and the hierarchy in which this should be placed. All of these give us at least a feel, we're not including myself scholars of usul, but at least it helps us to appreciate that some of those issues could be responsible for differing interpretation, differing understanding of the same text. So nobody is denying the text is there, but the way it is understood on sound jurisprudential ground could vary. The unfortunate thing that we find in this ummah, more unfortunate that it happens on the part of some scholars that we should have better expectation of them, that because they believe very strongly in one opinion, one interpretation, all others are wrong, are fisq, deviation from Islam, are bid'ahs, innovation in religion, and some even would call it, wal'iyazu billah, kufr. So kufr here is not disbelieving in Allah or His Prophet or the Quran. Kufr means not accepting the specific interpretation they give. Because again, they keep magnified and say, no, it's usul. It is something that is very essential and you're rejecting essential aspect. If our scholars give good example by simply saying, all right, I am more inclined to this opinion and I think this is the more correct one, but truth could be with you, as many of them said before, then the situation would be different. Then the followers of those scholars would not be as fanatic and dogmatic as we find them today. A person who is not a specialist is not a scholar. He might have read some books, memorized some this, some that, would stand to fire fatwas and consider this is fasiq, this is kafir, this is so and so. Sometimes this could be a result of intolerance on the part of that person, but it could also be a result of the intolerance of the scholar, who could be a good scholar, who taught him, that he was so much engulfed in his particular interpretation that he could not even open the possibility that he could be wrong. That's where everybody, including scholars, should ask their hearts. Is that done with the attitude of pride? Al-intisar al-ra'y, I have to get victory and prominence of my interpretation, not give attention to others, or say, all right, this is that. They're both based on sound reasoning, but this reasoning is better, but you have every right to follow legitimate interpretations. In fact, unfortunately, some people or scholars call themselves, I am a Hanafi scholar, I am a Hanbali scholar, I follow Ibn Taymiyyah, I follow Malik, I follow this and follow that, but in fact they're not following them. They might be following some aspect of their fiqh. There might be following all the verdicts given by that imam or scholar, but they're not following the humbleness and attitude of that scholar. You go to all the four major leaders of the school of jurisprudence, each one of them said basically the same thing. To give you a sample, in صح الحديث فهو مذهبي. If hadith is proven to be authentic, it is my madhab. One of them would say, if you find a hadith, a sound hadith on that subject, throw my opinion against the wall. One of them would say, I think it was الشافعي, said it beautifully, رأي صواب يحتمل الخطأ ورأي غيري خطأ يحتمل الصواب. Look at the humbleness. And Imam Shafi'i. And everybody who knows anything about fiqh knows the status of Imam Shafi'i, like Abu Hanifa and others. He says, my opinion is right, but could be proven wrong. And the other opinion is wrong, but could be proven right. But you know what is the motto of some people who come today in the garbs of scholars? رَأْيِ صَوَابٌ لَا يَحْتَمِلُ الْخَطَأُ وَرَأْيُ غَيْرِي خَطَأٌ لَا يَحْتَمِلُ الصَّوَابُ. As if they say, my opinion is right, that can never be wrong. The other opinion is wrong, but can never be right. The exact opposite of the humility of those who were true scholars. The more knowledgeable the person is, the more humble he has to be. It was Imam Shafi'i who once quoted a saying, كلما ازددت علما ازددت علما بجهلي. Those who know Arabic can appreciate its beauty. كلما ازددت علما ازددت علما بجهلي. The more I increase in knowledge, the more my knowledge increases about my ignorance. The more I realize my ignorance and how little I know. Like I say, results in the negative kind of disputes which I'm addressing in less than the remaining time even inshallah allocated. The negative difference. It is that negative difference that the Quran warns against. وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا. Fall, don't fall into disputation. That difference that leads to hatred, discourtesy, and hostility among Muslims unnecessarily. The negative difference is the one that seemed to reverse one important ayah in the Quran, and all the Quran is important, describing true believers. أَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ. They're stern and strict with the unbelievers, mean those who oppose them, but compassionate among themselves. But unfortunately, some Muslims behave the exact opposite. They're ruhama'u bil kuffari ashidda'u baynahum. They're more merciful with the non-believers, but more stern, more hostile among themselves. Where does this problem come from and how can we deal with it? Three things, in essence. There is a problem sometimes of iman, of intention. When our agenda in discussion of any issue is not the search for truth and abiding by that truth, but we have different agenda. I want to prove that I am the best, I am the most intelligent, I am the most right, my mazhab is the best, my sheikh is the only correct one. This is or hawa. I discuss with you because I have something in my mind, preset idea or conclusion. Even if you show me the greatest of truth, I will reject it because it doesn't go with my desire. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ was told also in the Quran, وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ عَمَّا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. Don't follow their desires as opposed to the truth given to you. Why? Allah gives us a very good reason for that in the Quran. وَلَوْ اتَّبَعَ الْحَقُّ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ لَفَسَدَتِ السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ وَمَنْ فِيهِمْ. If truth, the ultimate truth, follow the desires of people, there would be corruption in heavens and earth. Our hawa, our desire, change from time to time, from person to person. It cannot be the ultimate criterion for truth. It should not be the agenda for discussion. Second reason is a problem of knowledge. A person who would be more knowledgeable of one opinion, but not of others. Thirdly, and that's more important, and I believe it's one of the more serious ones, intolerance. And the lack of understanding of priorities. Suppose you have a difference in one point. Why should you be my enemy instead of being my brother? Why don't we unite in what we agree upon and excuse each other in small details that we differ thereon? The priorities are lost because we might be working with one jama'ah or the other. So all other jama'at are enemies. Ya akhi, even if you have reservation about some of the understanding or tactics of some jama'at, you should acknowledge the good thing in them. You don't tell me, all right, that brothers do not speak much about jihad. Ya akhi, fine, yes, Islam is more complete than what they teach, but they're not teaching sinful things. They have a major positive contribution to make when they remind people of salah and relationship with Allah. Alhamdulillah, work with them, accept that part, and forgive the other thing. This jama'ah is having that fault, fine, but it's not all evil. We don't see things always in terms of black and white, except in ultimate truth. But in the strategies, tactics, focus, we could vary. And finally, to deal with that comes also from these three points. First, sincerity, to purify our intention. Secondly, to seek correct knowledge. And one of the best ways is to study comparative fiqh, or to read at least books written by scholars of comparative fiqh, so that we don't fall into narrow madhabism, you might say. And finally, to teach ourselves how to be tolerant. And if our love is true for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then our love will also be for our brothers and sisters. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who love one another for his sake and struggle together to achieve his will. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallah khair. We can begin our formal second session of today's program. That is the question and answer session.
Assalamu alaikum. Question regarding donating body organs in Islam. If you could answer the question by reference to the Quran and the Hadith. Jazakallah khair.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Very briefly, there is no direct reference in Quran or Hadith to organ donation, as the issue, of course, was not raised at the time. So this is a matter of ijtihad by jurists, taking into account broader Islamic principles that impinge on that particular question. But to come directly to the answer to your question, yes, the scholar said that this is possible, especially when that's needed to save life or reduce suffering, provided that the person does not get any payment for that. Some jurists even said it is possible to donate even from a living person, provided that the life of that person is not endangered, like, for example, donating one kidney, as the person can live with even part of a kidney. What are the husband's duties toward his wife? How should he treat her? One category of duty includes support, food, clothing, shelter, recreation, and medication, and everything that's needed. Secondly, other duties that are more important, and that's good treatment. The Prophet ﷺ said, the best of you is the best of his family. And one of the things that would be included in good treatment of the wife, as explained by the great companion Ibn Abbas, adorn myself for my wife as she adorns herself for me. But on the other hand, also we must not forget that every duty is the other coin of responsibility. So the wife also have responsibilities. Maybe you can choose one of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam describe the great blessing of a woman or wife. If he looks at her, she pleases him. Not only that she adorns herself, but she's not uncheerful. Secondly, if he asks her to do something, she obeys, and obedience, as we know, of course, in Sharia, are within limits. There is no time to elaborate on them. It's not absolute orders, but reasonable requests. And thirdly, when he's absent, she would safeguard her honor and his property. Two more. One is about the question of what other leaders of a school of jurisprudence said, that if the hadith is proven authentic, it is my madhab. And one brother or sister, probably, I don't know, comment that this is meant for the knowledgeable people. And I fully agree that one of the greatest danger is that someone reads one hadith and becomes an instant mufti. You need more than reading hadith. You need to be very familiar with all the issues involved, both in the Quran and hadith. There are numerous examples that sometimes a hadith could have been superseded by another hadith. A hadith might be in a certain setting that has one particular implication. And to jump to conclusions on the basis of one hadith alone without looking into other texts is an erroneous methodology. And finally, a question from some sisters who are reversed to Islam, indicating that sometimes they get nightmare after they wake up for Fajr. This is very useful, which include, by the way, recitation of the last three surahs of the Quran. There are certain du'as also for people who wake up from a nightmare. It is found in various collections of books. One humble collection of mine is called the Selected Prayers, which was published by Taha Publication in the United Kingdom here. So there are du'as also to say, but always think positive, and maybe try when you go to sleep, run tape recording of the Quran and see if that might improve the situation. And inshallah, Allah be with you.
Assalamu alaikum. Is it permissible to do your prayers in English so long as you read Surah Fatiha in Arabic?
The basic rule in Sharia is that the acts of worship are so-called tawqifiyya. They are supposed to be done as instructed by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And one of the prerequisites for the acceptance of salah, that it would be or include the dua that the Prophet ﷺ taught and the Quran. And as you know, there is no translation of the Quran, there is interpretive translation of the meaning of the Quran. And if a person is able to recite Al-Fatiha, then the question becomes academic. Al-Fatiha is seven lines, Tasbih is one line, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, and Subhana Rabbi al-A'la is very simple and easy to memorize, so the question really is rather academic. I must say, for the sake of intellectual honesty also, that some said that if a person just accepted Islam, he's supposed to immediately begin prayers. If he did not have a chance yet to learn Al-Fatiha, they said that exceptionally he may recite the prayer in any language until he learns Surah Al-Fatiha. Today it might be easier even. If you have an exact situation like that, you can have it in transliteration and the person can just put it in front of him, Bismi, B-I-S-M, that would bring it closer. But Alhamdulillah, Allah made it easy. And let us remember that we should have priorities and distinguish between the essential and the additional. If a person just became Muslim and he can only recite Al-Fatiha, there is no need really to recite the additional surah at the time being in English until he learns one of the short surahs. His prayer is still correct even with Al-Fatiha alone.
We can begin our formal second session of today's program. That is the question and answer session.
Question regarding donating body organs in Islam. If you could answer the question by reference to the Quran and the Hadith. Jazakallah khair.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Very briefly, there is no direct reference in Quran or Hadith to organ donation, as the issue, of course, was not raised at the time. So this is a matter of ijtihad by jurists, taking into account broader Islamic principles that impinge on that particular question. But to come directly to the answer to your question, yes, the scholar said that this is possible, especially when that's needed to save life or reduce suffering, provided that the person does not get any payment for that. Some jurists even said it is possible to donate even from a living person, provided that the life of that person is not endangered, like, for example, donating one kidney, as the person can live with even part of a kidney. What are the husband's duties toward his wife? How should he treat her? One category of duty includes support, food, clothing, shelter, recreation, and medication, and everything that's needed. Secondly, other duties that are more important, and that's good treatment. The Prophet ﷺ said, the best of you is the best of his family. And one of the things that would be included in good treatment of the wife, as explained by the great companion Ibn Abbas, adorn myself for my wife as she adorns herself for me. But on the other hand, also we must not forget that every duty is the other coin of responsibility. So the wife also have responsibilities. Maybe you can choose one of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam describe the great blessing of a woman or wife. If he looks at her, she pleases him. Not only that she adorns herself, but she's not uncheerful. Secondly, if he asks her to do something, she obeys, and obedience, as we know, of course, in Sharia, are within limits. There is no time to elaborate on them. It's not absolute orders, but reasonable requests. And thirdly, when he's absent, she would safeguard her honor and his property. Two more. One is about the question of what other leaders of the school of jurisprudence said, that if the hadith is proven authentic, it is my madhab. And one brother or sister, probably, I don't know, comment that this is meant for the knowledgeable people. And I fully agree that one of the greatest danger is that someone reads one hadith and becomes an instant mufti. You need more than reading hadith. You need to be very familiar with all the issues involved, both in the Quran and hadith. There are numerous examples that sometimes a hadith could have been superseded by another hadith. A hadith might be in a certain setting that has one particular implication. And to jump to conclusions on the basis of one hadith alone without looking into other texts is an erroneous methodology. And finally, a question from some sisters who are reversed to Islam, indicating that sometimes they get nightmare after they wake up for Fajr. This is very useful, which include, by the way, recitation of the last three surahs of the Quran. There are certain du'as also for people who wake up from a nightmare. It is found in various collections of books. One humble collection of mine is called the Selected Prayers, which was published by Taha Publication in the United Kingdom here. So there are du'as also to say, but always think positive, and maybe try when you go to sleep, run tape recording of the Quran and see if that might improve the situation. And inshallah, Allah be with you.
Assalamu alaikum. Is it permissible to do your prayers in English so long as you read Surah Fatiha in Arabic?
The basic rule in Sharia is that the acts of worship are so-called tawqifiyya. They are supposed to be done as instructed by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And one of the prerequisites for the acceptance of Salah, that it would be or include the dua that the Prophet ﷺ taught and the Quran. And as you know, there is no translation of the Quran, there is interpretive translation of the meaning of the Quran. And if a person is able to recite Al-Fatiha, then the question becomes academic. Al-Fatiha is 7 lines, Tasbih is 1 line, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, and Subhana Rabbi al-A'la is very simple and easy to memorize, so the question really is rather academic. I must say, for the sake of intellectual honesty also, that some said that if a person just accepted Islam, he's supposed to immediately begin prayers. If he did not have a chance yet to learn Al-Fatiha, they said that exceptionally he may recite the prayer in any language until he learns Surah Al-Fatiha. Today it might be easier even. If you have an exact situation like that, you can have it in transliteration and the person can just put it in front of him, Bism, B-I-S-M, that would bring it closer. But Alhamdulillah, Allah made it easy. And let us remember that we should have priorities and distinguish between the essential and the additional. If a person just became Muslim and he can only recite Al-Fatiha, there is no need really to recite the additional surah at the time being in English until he learns one of the short surahs. His prayer is still correct even with Al-Fatiha alone.
Assalamu alaikum. I just want to ask, what is the limit on owning excessive amounts of clothes, jewelry, cars, etc.? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed me with many of these things, but still I cannot resist buying more every time I go to the shops, and I feel guilty.
Well, first of all, the basic rule is that buying clothes itself is not haram, and nobody has the right to say it is haram, so long as they are used for good. But the basic guiding rule also in the Quran, وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا, that eat and drink and commit no excesses, whether it's in food, drink, or clothes, is not desirable. And that's especially true when we know that there is so much suffering in the world and so much need there for da'wah and other charitable causes. So it's a matter that you have to judge for yourself based on your financial resources and what you feel is reasonably enough and without excess in your good Islamic judgment.
Questions to Sheikh Badawi. It's quite evident that there's strength in unity, and there's many, many organizations throughout the world who are all doing good works. But if these organizations were brought together and were united, then the Muslims would be in a lot stronger position than they are now. The question is, how could it be achieved?
I think what you raised is very important and timely, needed. But my suggestion, beside what has been already presented in the talk on the basic level in terms of ikhlas and proper knowledge and development of tolerance, that we should not aspire just to bring all organizations under one umbrella and call it one organization, to amalgamate them. Suffice at least to begin by not working against each other, by meeting together and working in areas where there's common understanding and common agreement. And as time goes on, we can reduce the areas of difference, and this way we can work together. So even some form of council, you might say, of Islamic organizations would be very useful. In the United States, by the way, this has been attempted, and there are some fruits also already emerging out of that. I have been attracted to a brother in the Islamic society. What can I do? Do like Khadija radiallahu anha, send some feeler, another sister, to find out if the person might be interested in marriage or not. Do the methodology of Khadija. It's respectable, no problem. What does it mean that Allah guides whoever He wishes and misguides whoever He wishes? The term guidance and misguidance is used in the Quran in more than one meaning. Guidance could mean a person is shown the way, and all human beings are shown the way. But there is another level of guidance. Those who respond to that innate nature that Allah inculcated in them, they receive additional help. By the same token, Allah does not arbitrarily yudill man yasha, in a sense arbitrarily and unfairly say, okay, I'm going to mislead or misguide that person. This is a very erroneous understanding of the ayat. It means that the person who rejects Allah and His message, Allah punishing him by letting him continue in his misguidance. There are two evidences from the Quran that are very interesting. First, فَلَمَّا أَزَاغُوا أَزَاغَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَهُمْ. When they deviated from the truth, Allah made their heart continue in that deviation. The other one, when people refer to the Quran, saying that Allah stamps on the heart of the unbelievers. But they forget also that another ayah says, بَلْطَبَعَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهَا بِكُفْرِهِمْ. Allah stamped on their heart by virtue of their rejection of faith. So there are two levels of meaning in guidance and misguidance. Another question basically say that sometimes you feel up, sometimes you feel your iman is weak. What is the reason for that? Well, many of the scholars say that an iman itself may increase or decrease, and that's why we have to keep watching all the time, resisting and coming back and purifying ourselves. There is nobody who is always feeling high except maybe very, very rare people. Another saying that I entered into the fold of Islam and somebody told me that I will be punished for what I did before that. The answer, not to my knowledge, because it is known that al-Islamu yajubbu ma qabla, that Islam would wipe away the sins before that and then you begin a new page. Is it possible for a woman to work if there is no need for that? We cannot say that woman working is haram in itself unless the work itself is haram or an atmosphere which is haram, which applies to men as well. But whether it is needed or not, it's a matter of reasonable judgment. If she's married, for example, and have small babies who need her care and attention, then the priorities might change likewise. But you cannot give a blanket answer to that. Another aspect is that some people say that it is difficult. I've been practicing Islam, but it's difficult to wake up for Fajr and I feel guilty about that. Well, this, you require jihad. You see, jihad is not just fighting in the battle. That's one form. You need jihad in nafs also, struggle against oneself. So try your best, especially when you remember the great reward of waking up for Fajr prayer. And by the way, don't forget to set your alarm before you sleep. When people refer to the Quran saying that Allah stamps on the heart of the unbelievers, but they forget also that another ayah says, بَلْ طَبَعَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهَا بِكُفْرِهِمْ. Allah stamped on their heart by virtue of their rejection of faith. So there are two levels of meaning in guidance and misguidance. Another question basically say that sometimes you feel up, sometimes you feel your iman is weak. What is the reason for that? Well, many of the scholars say that an iman itself may increase or decrease, and that's why we have to keep watching all the time, resisting and coming back and purifying ourselves. There is nobody who is always feeling high except maybe very, very rare people. Is it possible for a woman to work if there is no need for that? We cannot say that woman working is haram in itself unless the work itself is haram or an atmosphere which is haram, which applies to men as well. But whether it is needed or not, it's a matter of reasonable judgment. If she's married, for example, and have small babies who need her care and attention, then the priorities might change likewise. But you cannot give a blanket answer to that. Another aspect is that some people say that it is difficult. I've been practicing Islam, but it's difficult to wake up for Fajr and I feel guilty about that. Well, this, you require jihad. You see, jihad is not just fighting in the battle. That's one form. You need jihad in nafs also, struggle against oneself. So try your best, especially when you remember the great reward of waking up for Fajr prayer. And by the way, don't forget to set your alarm before you sleep. What is the ruling of a man who beats his wife without any prior reason? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered that question, so I have nothing to say except what he said. When some women complained to his wives that their husband beat them, he said, "Laysu ulaika bikhiyarikum." These are not the best of you. And even with the strict limitation in the case of nushuz, which I explained in some detail, it's in 4-page footnote in my book, Gender Equity, that even the word beat in English does not really meet the Sharia requirement of even the extreme case of nushuz. Even then, the Prophet ﷺ say, وَلَنْ يَضْرِبَ خِيَارَكُمْ. The best of you will never resort to this measure, even if there is a fault on the part of the wife. And he never himself practiced that, and he's our uswa, he's our example. By the way, some jurists said that if a husband exceeds the limits in his treatment of his wife, she can complain to a judge if it cannot be resolved within the family, but the judge may order him some punishment which may include beating, but sparing the wife from the duty of beating her husband because she's the one who's going to get it. So he could order him being beaten or punished in some form to correct his behavior. But of course, we don't have an Islamic state to apply that, at least here. Another thing that says that, does a girl have to wear hijab to prove she is a good Muslim? You don't have to prove to anyone. You don't prove. You obey Allah and His Messenger. So you don't approach it from the stand of showing off to anyone or impressing anyone. It is true that some people may wear hijab and still gamble. I've seen some people told me some women in hijab were gambling in a gambling casino. But this does not necessarily mean those who wear hijab gamble. It means that there is a sort of superficial understanding. There's cultural hijab. People wear hijab just as a culture rather than those who wear it as a command of Allah and His Messenger. But on the other hand, it would be honest also to say that since this is a requirement, it is mentioned in the Quran, it is mentioned in several hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then of course a sister who observes hijab with that conviction, with that understanding, is better than one who has not yet reached that stage. But I hope inshallah all eventually will reach that. How does one be humble? Remember the hereafter, remember of what you were created and where you're going to be. Do women enjoy the same rights in a non-Islamic society? Islam supersedes, and if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given women certain privileges and rights and responsibilities, let's not forget that, and the same for men, then regardless where they are living, the rights do not change. And the basic rule in the Quran, اتقوا الله ما استطعتم, fear Allah as best as you could. Even if the laws are not in line with Islam, do your best to implement the Islamic law as best as you can. What's your opinion about video films and photography? Some scholars say there is no harm in that. Actually, you're not imitating the creation of Allah. You're just depicting things in their reality as they are. Is it permissible for women to pay in jama'ah, in congregation? If so, should the leader stand in front? The answer has been given already, that Aisha radiallahu anha used to lead women in prayer, but she stands with them in the line, let's say in the middle of the first line. One question basically says that how can we really project Islam properly if there are weak hadiths? And someone quoted me from a tape that was made before, that I said that it is a weak hadith that was attributed to Umar radiallahu an, that you should consult women but do otherwise. I must make a correction here. I didn't say that this is a weak hadith. I said that this is a fabricated hadith, which should not be called hadith. And there is a difference between a totally fabricated hadith that is not even regarded as weak and a weak hadith. A weak hadith means a hadith that has some relevance, but there is some weakness in the narration, in which case it could not be a basis for a definitive rule in Sharia. But that's different from a totally fabricated, and the example given by the sister is a totally fabricated one that doesn't have any base. But let's, again, not forget that even in weak hadith, the scholar differentiate between weak and very weak. So there are various kind of gradation of hadith other than the totally fabricated one that should be totally rejected. And again, a fabricated hadith, like I say, is just like she says, you cannot say, I am slightly pregnant. I mean, it's either you're pregnant or it's not a hadith at all. But other hadith could have degrees. As a wife, is it wrong for me to ask my husband to trim his beard? Yes, if that pricks too much in your face. I'm just joking. Well, first of all, you must realize that the husband who is wearing a beard is following the sunnah. And there are some scholars also who interpret the beard as one that should not be trimmed. There is some differing opinion in that. So we hope, inshallah, that the beard, his hair, will not be soft enough that it doesn't hurt you. If it's a matter of pricking too much, maybe you should negotiate something with him, but still follow the sunnah. Is it allowed to put photos of the family up the wall? There have been, again, varying opinion on the question of pictures and the purpose behind it. You can check Dr. Qaradawi's book, The Lawful and Forbidden in Islam. My preference, even if you take the lenient opinion of keeping family pictures, to keep it in an album rather than on the wall. After childbirth, can women read the Quran during the period? What has been at least one interpretation, because the word, the Quran should only be touched by the purified, as we heard that it has also a different interpretation. But out of reverence and respect to the Quran also, a man who is junub, who needs to take a bath before he can pray, or a woman also during her period or postnatal, should avoid direct touching of the Quran. However, Imam Shafi'i says that any book that contains more than half non-Quran, which include translations or commentary, does not have the same ruling as the Quran. My preference for a sister in that state, maybe, alhamdulillah, lots of tapes are available, CDs, and you can listen to the Quran. There is no harm, inshallah. Can you please why mortgage is haram? Well, because mortgage is based on interest. Mortgage technically is a loan at a certain rate of interest amortized over a certain number of years. But I would suggest, again, for those who are interested to buy homes, to study the method which has been applied successfully in Canada with more than three homes under the system, rent-to-buy type of arrangement. There is a brief description of that in Album 5 of the Islamic Teaching Series in the Economic System of Islam. But there are lots of information available. Maybe it needs somebody to move them. It has been implemented, by the way, also in Australia, very successfully. Whose duty is to pay zakah, husband or wife? Both, if they have their personal property. Let us remember that if a sister gets married and she has her own property prior to marriage or earn any money after marriage, it is entirely her property and nobody has control over her. And if it is her property, then she's required to pay zakah as her husband. She pays zakah only on her personal property. Her husband, if he has more than the nisab, then he's also supposed to pay zakah on his own property. So both of them may pay zakah if they meet the requirement. Is it permissible to have a test tube baby? No babies are made in the test tube. The fertilization takes place in the test tube, but it is re-implanted in the uterus of the mother. Some scholars said, so long as you have the sperm and the ovum from the natural biological parents, not from someone else, and the zygote is implanted, I hope I used the correct term, is implanted in the uterus of the biological natural mother for a reason like tubal blockage or some other reason that prevent fertilization, it can be regarded as a sort of treatment. Again, the condition from the natural parents only. What is the best way to approach a non-Muslim with the Quran? Should we explain how he should deal with the Quran? Yes. How could you make da'wah if you deprive people from reading the Quran? But on the other hand, if you give it to someone, please bring to the attention that this is a holy book that we respect as the word of Allah. We would appreciate if you don't take it to the washroom, if you don't throw it around or put books on top of it. And I think any decent person probably will do that. But again, it's available in the marketplace. You can only appeal to people's decency and good sense.
Can you please, in the light of the Quran and the Sunnah, the strong need of jihad against the non-believers in nowadays? Like, why we need jihad? Why aren't the Muslim Ummah doing jihad?
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about jihad against the kuffar and munafiqeen, beside in the battlefield, فَلَا تُطْعِ الْكَافِرِينَ وَجَاهِدْهُمْ بِهِ جِهَادًا كَبِيرًا. Telling to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, don't obey the unbeliever and make jihad against them with it. With it here means the Quran. I think it would be a mistake to think that the only form of jihad against the unbelievers is carrying arms. This has been permitted under certain circumstances with certain guidelines. We know that the Quran does not shoot bullets, drop bombs, or emit missiles. Obviously, jihad with the Quran means jihad with the truth of the Quran. Have we tried that first? I think that's what we should do.